uncomfortable conversations about culture and Christianity. My name is Eric, and today I'm joined by Jess.
Hello, world.
And Alex.
Speaking of the world, I'd love to give a big shout out to the world champion Paralympic basketball team, United States of America, ladies and gentlemen. They won gold again, which is actually interesting. I'll be honest, this is the first time I've really paid attention to it, and really the Paralympics in general. I love the Olympics and have always kind of really been passionate about watching those, but I feel like the Paralympics have always kind of had a backseat. But the journey for a lot of those athletes to get there is even more difficult in a lot of ways. And so it reminded me of our friend, more Eric's friend because he lives in Iowa, but Josh Turek.
I can only be friends with people in Iowa.
Yes. Well, and yeah. You knew him.
Yeah.
From episode 105, he actually played on the Paralympic U.S. basketball team. And that was just a fun episode.
It was. I think that was one of my top 10. I really liked that one.
Yeah, really explained to us like the dedication, what it takes to be a part of the Paralympics, the coverage or the lack of coverage that they get, and even brought in probably the first and only time we'll ever wear an Olympic gold medal.
Yeah, yeah.
So that was super cool. And they're heavier than, it wasn't a Paris one because he didn't participate this time.
Yeah.
But yeah, that was just kind of a fun thing, and it made me more interested this year, so... Congrats.
Way to get it done.
USA.
Episode 105. Go listen to that one if you really do want to hear about someone's story and their journey in the Paralympics and just life. It's cool stuff.
Yeah. Shout out to all the cherry pickers out there that picked this episode today.
Yep. There you go.
Alex, it's been a while, but I've heard a rumor that we might have a voicemail.
We've got a voicemail.
That's exciting.
All right.
It's the first voicemail of... Like after our summer break.
It is.
So this is a big deal.
All right, here it is. Maybe if I learn how to play it.
Hey, podcast crew, quick question for you. How do you as pastors and ministry leaders navigate through the perceived expectation that you should live a better life or perhaps even the false expectation that some congregants may have on you that you should live a sinless life? Curious your thoughts on this.
Whoa, we're just... going for it today.
Going.
I feel like this is maybe like kind of, this is actually pretty applicable to what we're going to be talking about later. Wow. Alex, you got this one? And he did say he's a pastor.
Pastors, ministry leaders.
I know, but he said pastor first, so I'm going to.
I even think I find that it falls on top of therapists too, because I'm like, people that know that I'm a therapist, I find them even watching like how I parent my kids and like, what would Jess do in this situation? So.
Oh, that's what those bracelets mean.
Yeah, WWJD.
This whole time, I thought it was Jesus.
No, it is Jesus.
What would Jess do? This is amazing. Brings whole new life to the term.
Wow.
So, like, you're more, you know, you're like more self-conscious about yelling at your child at the Walmart checkout or something.
I'm aware of people watching me.
Yeah.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah. How do you navigate it? I mean, I think... there certainly is a call that there is, you know, some responsibility and accountability for people that I think much is given, you know, whether that's leadership, influence, responsibility. And then even in James, it talks, you know, about pastors and our responsibility as shepherding a flock. So there is like that pressure in some ways that can be felt to present yourself as perfect. I've talked about this, I think, several times, even with like the whole living room analogy of like a lot of us ultimately want to do that. We want to clean up our lives or make it look like nobody actually lives in our living rooms. And, you know, I think all of us have kind of the same temptation to do that. I'm just grateful that I learned early and that one of the values, at least for me, that I have is authenticity. And I've learned more that just better ministry happens when I'm able to share some of the, in the right spaces, you know, the struggles going on in my life, the victories happening in my life. I try to implement psalming my life, in some of those ways, but it is interesting. It's a fun and tedious place to live, I think, at times. But there is, if somebody expects that I'm sinless, then they won't have to hang out with me for too long to find out I'm not. And the biggest thing for me, honestly, and you guys probably know this, is I think a lot of people see me or hear me on the podcast, or they see me on stage here at the church, and I'm, you know, very animated and all those kind of things. But my face is not the nicest looking face when I'm just like sitting there and listening to people. So there are several people that have like, really, that throws them off, because they always see me like on, like energetic, excited, passionate. And then when they see me just like listening, or if I'm like actually sitting and they're presenting something, they like wonder if I hate them, if I'm judging them. And so usually that's like the bigger thing that I have to fight against, is I think people, not just because of my face, but in general, I think people sometimes assume that I'm judging them, or I have some kind of special ability or assignment that it's God given that I have the authority to judge them and make some kind of calls on their life. And so that's probably the pressure I feel more in my own life.
Yeah. I think for me, it probably, I mean, I probably feel a little bit, I guess, in a different category. If you want to consider me a ministry leader, that would probably be appropriate. But I you know, you represent, I think anybody, wherever they work, represents to a certain extent the organization that they're working for. And so I think it's, even if you're in the marketplace, it's critical that you carry yourself in a way that's respectable in public. And you do, you know, even on social media to a certain extent, you consider who you're representing. I think for me, a lot of it started even as a kid, being a pastor's kid and growing up in that environment. I learned a lot of the wrong ways to do that, the way to like, I don't know, behavior modification, ways to, because it's almost like living a double life, I think, when I was growing up, because there was a part of me that's like, oh, well, I like this thing, or I like to do this, or I like this type of music, or I like, you know what, I like these types of movies and things like that, but I can't let the congregation know I enjoy any of this stuff.
Because you're aware of the pressure people are putting on your parents.
And they're like, they're gonna think badly of parents or me or whatever that is. And so, you know, I internalized a lot of that as a kid. And but yeah, I would say now it's always a delicate balance, because I think as much as we're called like to be like Jesus, I do want people to know that, you know, ministers and leaders, I mean, we're all human beings, and I think we're all going to struggle, we're all going to go through different things, and it takes accountability, it takes community, it takes people, I mean, it takes people in the church to, you know, maybe to call, I mean, I think even on this podcast we've had people bring up questions, and you kind of know where they're coming from, you know, like, is this okay, is that okay? And I think it's good to have that kind of friction in your life, just so you know, like, hey, I should take a account of this and look at it and think through it in different viewpoint, from different viewpoints. And yeah, I don't know, but I never want to feel like, I don't want anyone else to feel like I'm unapproachable or something like that because of my role, I guess. Like, I would never consider myself holier than anyone else or something like that, just because I'm working at a church.
Mm-hmm. I think like similar to you, but different, obviously grew up different life, but like grew up feeling like, in my culture, it was like, I couldn't share what was happening at home. So it was like, I was living like this double life of like having to have everything together. And I think you learn a lot when you're in that environment as a kid. And so, especially like being someone that's like aware of other people watching you and like, oh, I learned like this is, if we're happy and we do it this way and say it perfectly, then people respond well to that. Mm-hmm. And I think it has a lot, like a lot of maturity in leadership and in ministry comes from learning that lesson of where is your identity. And then I find as a leader that the position of I don't know and I struggle too is one of the most validating things that you can do as a leader. Cause it's like, I don't feel, because I've learned a lot of lessons from that and choose to live a more authentic life, sometimes that doesn't look pretty and I have to check myself a lot, or you guys have to check me of like, whoa, Jess, what are you saying? But I think that there's a lot of validity, and then that's where your walk with the Lord comes in. And so I don't know. For me, I think that we do feel that pressure, that tension, but it's more of an expectation that we're aware of now. But then it's like, how does our past culture and experiences meet expectations? And then also living in a space of, okay, it's okay. Like, I don't know. I'm a therapist. I don't know how to raise or talk to my 10-year-old all the time. Like, I don't have a marriage that we never fight or shocking, right? But I think like just the struggle of that is authentic. It's okay to not be perfect.
Yeah. What a question. I think we should
send we probably could have just
the WWJD bracelet.
It's a good reminder. All right. Yeah. So today we are going to be talking about some Barna study results in church culture trends. And kind of you'll discover these stats as we kind of process them out loud with you. And that's up next. Okay, here we go. We've got this boot. Alex, you prepared this lovely boot, which we haven't.
The boot hasn't made an appearance for a while. Yeah, if you're watching.
Is it pewter? We always discuss the pewter.
Material. It's literally a cowboy boot. That was probably is that a vase or something that somebody would drink out of? It could be either.
I think it's long ago, one of my first small groups, like White Elephant Christmas party gifts.
What was it a gift at?
Like a white elephant. Like it was just a random vase? No, it's just
decor.
Yeah.
Looks like it probably was purchased at Borsheim's. Yeah, there it is.
It was purchased at Borsheim's.
No, I'm thinking not. I'm totally kidding.
Okay.
So anyways, we decided there's 10 stats in here
more home
goods that are like from Barna church culture trends, and we're just gonna kind of pull one out, and there's some questions attached to it, and discuss it. Just because I think some of these, as we were going through them, are pretty surprising. I think they will be to listeners too.
Yeah, and these are all from 2023. So when they released, these studies of church and culture trends. So who gets the
Who wants to go first?
Drum roll. How about ladies first?
All right.
Aww.
There you go, Jess.
Our first statistic.
Yeah.
16% of pastors have a succession plan in place. Alex?
16% have a succession.
Are you one of the 16?
Plans. I don't have a succession plan in place for my position. No.
We're keeping you. You're staying around. That's your succession plan. Alex will help you with that. Okay, but really, are we surprised or not by it's 16%? I mean, that feels low. Like when we think about other statistics, like, is that a high number?
I mean,
do we see this?
It seems low, but it's also not like
it's not 2%.
I'm not surprised by it because I guess maybe it is that PK in me that's like, yeah, and it's not that I don't think it's narcissism or anything, but I think that a lot of times pastors are just kind of in it and they're like, this is the ministry that's happening, and they're not probably, because I think a lot of times you in ministry, you do have that sense of, I need to be listening to God's spirit where he's leading me. And I think sometimes that doesn't really lend itself to planning for the future necessarily.
Very good point.
So I think, I don't think it's about like, oh, I'm the best and no one's ever going to be able to replace me, but it is more about, hey, I'm in this season. This is where I'm at and this is what I'm focused on. And sometimes that season turns into several seasons before people think about planning for the end.
That's a good point.
Yeah, I think probably the difficult thing about, a succession plan inside of a church is figuring out, like, projecting that God's going to call me somewhere else, kind of like you were saying, Eric, in 3 years from now. I can see towards retirement or things like that, as a pastor is aging and maybe feels like, hey, I've led this church through, whatever span or whatever era that needs to happen inside of this church. And I feel like God's saying, hey, it's time for fresh leadership. It's time for, a new voice or voices to be a part of it. I would say that number seems a little bit low. I mean, that there should probably be some kind of plan maybe more of an emergency plan. I know we even talked about some of that, like when the pandemic happened, when no one knew what COVID was. I remember just some of that happening around here about, okay, who's going to take some of the preaching and who's going to do that? Like if Mark was in the hospital, you know, for months on end or something happened, there was this creation of that. And I think of a few churches in Omaha that, that have really been intentional about this. I think of Lifegate. They recently, you know, had a lead pastor, Pastor Les, that was there for decades. And now Micah is leading there. I think of King of Kings, is another, church that had, you know, Pastor Mark Zender there for a long time. And now, Greg is the pastor. And so I think there's a few churches in Omaha that have been thinking about this. Mm-hmm. And it probably depends on just your church's culture. Like I grew up in like a lot more small church culture where there was probably a lot more like dad is the senior pastor and then son becomes the senior pastor. Maybe like Judah Smith, for example, is one of those people. His dad was a pastor and then he took over. And so sometimes there's the mess maybe that happens inside of those kind of systems, but
yeah.
Well, I think I was looking up the average age of a pastor right now, and in 2013 it was 55, and then in 2022 it went down to about 53.84 as the average. So I mean, it hasn't changed much, but I do think about, as a 42-year-old, I don't consider 55 to be very old right now. That doesn't feel that far for me, but I do think about seeing pastors go into ministry years past when you're talking 80s and 90s and even the early 2000s, there was a lot more younger pastors. And I think now those pastors are kind of living with that ministry, you know? So it just seems like there's not as many opportunities unless they're just going to go start another church for, even then you don't see that many like 20 somethings going out and starting a church.
I think go ahead, Jess. Sorry.
If you're saying the same thought I had.
I don't know if I'm saying the same thought. We'll find out.
No, I doubt it. But one thing that I was thinking about is it's just interesting how maybe a pastor wouldn't have a succession plan. And I don't think every church is like this, but I have seen this play out at Christ Community and at other churches in Omaha where there's another natural leader, whether it's the head pastor position or another position at the church that needs to be filled. It's like there was another person doing a different job or something that's like, this is your next step, or this is like such a natural thing for you because we've been preparing these people. So it just makes me think about like, okay, how are we investing in the people that aren't necessarily the head pastor? How are we setting them up? I know when I was transitioning out of Christ Community over to City Care, that there was already somebody that I was like, hey, this would be a great person to fill this spot. And so how do you think that we're, I guess, preparing those people, like thoughts on
that? Yeah, that is kind of what I was thinking of in some ways is I think automatically our minds go to senior pastor role here. And there are, you know, a lot of ministry leaders. Like for me, I have left, you know, a church, and you know, big value for me was, hey, I made a decision in February that I was gonna, you know, show up to Christ Community and start working here, and was super excited about it. But I also was like, I'm committed to these kids till April, so if I'm gonna finish the year so I can prepare the next ministry leaders for what that looks like, or even when I transition from middle school ministry here. I think if you're not at least thinking about, if something happened to me, who am I training up that can shepherd these people? Who am I introducing to build relationships with these people, building bridges? Who am I intentionally raising up that could fill in and do a lot of the ministry that I'm doing? And not even just ministry leaders, but equipping the saints to do the work of the ministry. If you're not thinking about how could this ministry survive and even thrive without me, then I think you're not leading, you know, very well in that kind of capacity. So I think you should always be thinking, at least internally, even if it's not like this public thing, like, okay, who am I training? Who am I raising up? Who could step into this? Mm-hmm. And will this ministry continue to thrive without me? Because if the answer is no, then I don't think you're leading a very healthy ministry at all. And so I think we have a residency program and things like that at Christ Community that are designed because we also see less and less people are going into maybe traditional full-time ministry. Mm-hmm. And so that's, I think, one of the ways in our small C context of church, meaning our local body, that I think we're trying to figure out. And we have filled, to your point, Jess, a lot of ministry roles through people that were a part of that program.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. All right, I'm gonna go next. Just taking initiative here.
Go, Eric.
All right. Paper removed from boot. 74% of U.S. adults desire spiritual growth. Okay. That's kind of a broad statement. Is that...
That's a high number,
Christian
too.
Spiritual growth?
I would assume not. So. I'm assuming not, like, just Christian spiritual. I think it could be
any spiritual growth.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So spirituality, like Buddhism in general.
Or, yeah, I think there's, I sense and see, like, in culture, just more mm-hmm. of an openness toward this isn't all there is, you know, mm-hmm. like just what we see, what we feel, what we touch, all those things, that there's something bigger behind the scenes, and then people are on these spiritual discovery paths. And our hope, I think, as Christians, is that they would find that the truth is in Jesus. But I do see, you know, a lot more people just into all sorts of spirituality and practices and things that maybe...
Tarot cards,
things we'd label kind of more in that witchcraft area, that are just noticing that there's just something deeper mm-hmm. than this. I would be surprised if 74%, if the stat meant 74% were interested in Christianity specifically, but mm-hmm. it's not as surprising that they're interested in spirituality to me.
I don't think I'm surprised either, because I think a lot of things in our culture, there's been so many tragedies, especially, I mean, we can look back. I mean, there's always tragedies in every generation and every decade, but mm-hmm. even in the past decade, I mean, just the tragedies that have come out and just the things that are happening on sometimes a daily basis. It's like this week was 9/11, and just like how church attendance went up like around that time when that happened, of just people turn to like a higher power, or they are searching for something. And like you're saying, Eric, like they are looking for answers. They want to connect to something deeper. And so I just think, like, even our culture and just like the devastation mm-hmm. makes us say, okay, we can't do this alone. And I know there's something more. What is that? And what's that connection? And so,
yeah, I think there was I don't remember the exact episode when Mark Ashton had joined us, but we were talking about how we've kind of started to enter into the postmodern world, where people are less reliant on facts. Facts have become more fluid and left to interpretation, mm-hmm. and people rely on their own truths. And as we move further and further into that, I think spirituality is something that people are much more open to, where it's like, I think my generation moved far from that, where we were looking for facts and we were looking for proof of everything and trying to always explain the Bible in very scientific terms. And, well, how could this happen? Or, you know, that sort of thing, to help grow our faith. Where now I think people, I mean, I think it just happens. It's a tired analogy, but it is that pendulum swing of, you know, parents raise their kids this way because they were influenced the other way. And so that pendulum is just going to keep swinging back and forth. And so now you're seeing the younger generation of like, I don't know that I've had an encounter with God in the same way that my parents or my grandparents have talked about. And that's something that I'm desiring. Mm-hmm. And, or if it's something else, it's like you said, Jess, I think when you feel the tyranny and injustice of a world around you, you're looking for an answer. And sometimes the simple answers just don't quite cut it, because you feel like there's got to be more to it. And I don't know. There's just, I feel like there's a lot more that we could get into, but it is, I think people are hungry for something like that. I think they're looking.
Well, and I think we're made in the image of God ultimately. And that's part of, I'm not like a person that's like, you've got a God-sized hole in your heart type mm-hmm. of person. But Romans 1 does say like, hey, that God created us in his image. And since the beginning of the world creation, God has revealed himself to us in invisible qualities, eternal power, divine nature, like that God he is revealing himself to us through these sources, through nature, through just being made in his image, demands us to ask, you know, these questions that put us on this spiritual quest. And so I think that's just a part of how God created humans, and that we are on that, that kind of spiritual quest. So yeah. Next one. 56% of Christians experience doubt primarily due to hypocrisy.
Oof.
Are we surprised that over half of Christians experience doubt, and it says primarily that is due to hypocrisy? Are we surprised by that?
No.
No, I'm not either.
Next question.
No. High five.
I mean, I have some thoughts on this. I mean, I think... I mean, I don't know that we talk about it as much in the modern church about our witness and what that means, but like your witness is how you as a believer present yourself to an unbelieving world. And we've definitely maybe dwelled on this in a number of different ways, whether we've, when we've talked about conspiracy theories or how people have reacted to new media being released, whether it's a new Netflix series or a new movie, and we see parents reacting, or how we see Christians react in political circles. And I think a lot of times when we are outspoken about things that don't really matter but are very tied to people's emotions, we hurt our witness. And it's easy to get trapped in that and become hypocrites very quickly when we're out there, you know, pointing at the logs in everybody's eyes, you know what I mean, and not seeing this, or pointing at the specks in everyone else's eyes and not seeing the logs in our own. But it's just one of those things where I think that, to me, it just isn't, it's not surprising at all, because I see it every day. And I think social media is definitely the place where I see it the most. But I think you just see a lot of Christians who are out there trying to win arguments instead of trying to win souls, and kind of making a bad witness for Jesus Christ.
Mm-hmm. I automatically started thinking, that song started playing in my head, you know, the DC Talk song where the Brennan Manning opens up and he says, what? The greatest single cause of atheism in the world today is Christians who acknowledge Jesus with their lips, walk out the door, and deny him with their lifestyle.
Is that Jesus freak?
That what if is what an unbelieving world simply
what if I stumble?
Finds unbelievable. Oh, what if I stumble?
Oh, yeah. That's the one.
Is this one for the people? Anyway, no. So that automatically, when I read that stat, that's what it reminded me of. And yeah, I think a lot of what you're saying, Eric, is true. I think people want... And even what Jesus demands of us, you know, are not things that we're always talking about. I remember we had a conversation with Father Damien from one of our Catholic brothers, and we talked about like having ecumenical conversations, and we talked about that prayer in John 17 that Jesus prayed and said, hey, this is how the world is going to know that you're my disciples, by the way you love one another. Mm-hmm. And I think we just don't do the one another stuff very well, like loving one another and finding unity. Like we pick apart like the 5-10% we disagree on and spend a lot of our time spinning, 90% of our time spinning on that stuff, rather than, hey, let's unite under the banner of who Jesus is and let's love others well, which I think first begins. And I think the problem with why we don't love people well is that we first forget that we're beloved. And I mean, Jesus, you know, says that like we love, why? Because he first loved us. And so when I'm not very loving, it's because I'm failing to really understand the depth of how loved I am. Or when I'm forgetful people are not forgiving people, I think. And so I think the more we forget about, you know, how messed and wretched we were, not in like in a way for us to dwell on that. Mm-hmm. But the more we realize, man, the gap that was there and how much Christ loved us, the more I think loving we will become to neighbor. And yeah, Jesus talks about this so much in so many places, the what love looks like. And I think we often don't do that well. We do things we say are in the name of love that come across as very resentful or resounding. Like, I mean, mm-hmm. getting into 1 Corinthians 13, like a gong, you know,
yeah.
but we have not love. You have all these things, you have all these spiritual gifts, but you have not love. Then you're just like a resounding cymbal, a clanging gong. Nobody wants to pay attention. You're just annoying. And mm-hmm. I think that's a big part of it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I also think back to even the question that we got at the beginning of the episode, our voicemail, it's like there is a, like even the caller said, like there's a pressure for ministry leaders to have it all together and to be perfect. And when we're not, if that's the front and we don't see the chinks in your armor, then when we see you mess up and this is like what you're, how you're presenting yourself, then that is going to lead to doubt. That is going to lead to hurt. And then I even just feel like we need to acknowledge the amounts of pastors and churches that have protected abusers and mm-hmm. have, I mean, covered up scandals. And when those things get out, that leads to so much doubt and hurt. And I think the answer is to be transparent. That's one of the reasons that I love and I've stayed at Christ Community. Not that we have everything perfect, but we have leadership that says, hey, like, not necessarily that something happened here, but like, hey, we want to address, like, this is happening in our community, or there's a question here, like, let's talk about it and be transparent. And I think that's the only way to counter that hypocrisy. And exactly what you're saying, Alex, is that what's the position that we're coming from? And it's of love, and it's of that authentic space where we don't have to be perfect, but we're also not covering it up with like this bright, shiny expectation.
Yeah. That's good.
Here's the boot. Yes.
It's your turn.
Oh, yep. Yeah, baby.
On the rotation. Pick the right one. This is
hopefully
exciting.
Here it comes.
Always thrilling.
Ooh, 53%. Of Gen Z teens are motivated to learn about Jesus. So Gen Z would be anyone born between 1997 and 2012. So everyone just feel old.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And that's right, like a sliding scale, yeah. depending on who it is. But
yeah. So how does our ministry engage with Gen Z's curiosity about Jesus? Like, is it surprising? Like, is it surprising? How do we engage with them? I think that's a good question, because these are kind of our next wave of leaders.
I think there's probably older generations who would not believe that statistic, because they see Gen Z culture playing out on TikTok and YouTube, and they would not believe that that's a culture that is motivated to learn about Jesus. But I think this kind of goes back to one of our first ones about adults even desiring spiritual growth. Mm-hmm. I think, yeah, Gen Z, they are, one of the things about that generation is it seems like they're a lot more thoughtful than the generations that came before them. And so I'm not too surprised by that, but I'm also curious why, like, what they're motivated by, you know, to learn about Jesus.
Yeah, someone that worked in student ministry for a long time, I'm not overly shocked by this. Again, to some of the points that you said, I think a lot of older generations, I think every generation does this, the one after them. We think we're smarter. We think we figured out life better, all that kind of stuff. But I'm always amazed to see how students respond to Jesus and how they are bold. We had a podcast with some students, and I was just blown away by their courage, the boldness. Some of the best leaders, I think, inside of our church even, are people that fall into Gen Z. I think that the problem is sometimes we don't allow them to lead, or we don't allow them to flourish, because we're like, we have our spot, or we, you know, kind of get in the way of that. And we're like, once you get it all figured out, and this feeds back into the, you know, the earlier questions too, but then we have to pretend like we have it all figured out, or we have it more figured out than them. And so then we kind of suppress their ability to lead, but they don't have a, they don't get like a junior version of the Holy Spirit and all of a sudden they graduate high school mm-hmm. or they go to Bible college and now they get the varsity version. Right. And so I think we have to realize, you know, those types of things and remember, you know, the power and the voice that they have and the things that they're, the people they're able to uniquely reach that I'll never right. be able to uniquely reach. And so,
well, it becomes this battle for relevancy and with older generations too, where you want to maintain relevancy. You want to be seen as relevant to a younger generation. And I mean, sometimes I think you do a disservice to your own generation. There's still people of your generation that need to be reached. There's still, you still mm-hmm. have a calling on your life. It doesn't discredit that. But I may be preaching to the choir, but it's like, you know, maybe there's moments in your younger life where you're like, oh, I should have been more bold. I should have acted in faith. I should have taken the risks. And, you know, I missed those spots in my life. And so now maybe you're like a little resentful about that. So now mm-hmm. I'm going to like try to grasp for relevancy with younger generations to justify my existence in some ways. But I think it's a good reminder to know, hey, you're part of a generation because there's a generation of people out there and they need to be reached just as much. And it doesn't invalidate your existence if you're not relevant to younger generations. Mm-hmm. Let them do God's work in their own capacity. Be there to support them. Be there to raise them up. Be there to mentor them. Be there to, you know, so they can learn from your mistakes. But don't have a heavy hand over it and try to control everything. And mm-hmm. it's tough. It's tough because I think that, especially as a person that's older than that generation, you're like, well, I don't want to see them make the same mistakes. But you know, sometimes mm-hmm. that's the best way to learn.
Well, and Gen Z is coming off the heels of a generation that is at large deconstructing their faith.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yep.
And so they're coming off of a generation that it would seem never really had an authentic faith, that they kind of knew the answers. They knew how to play the church game. They knew how to, you know, be involved in that kind of stuff, but they didn't really have, you know, people that were authentically creating spaces for them to explore faith, to ask questions. Yeah. And so they were suppressed in a lot of ways of those questions, whether it's about, you know, science, faith, politics, whatever. And so because they were suppressed, when they get into the quote unquote real world and they start asking questions, and then the church doesn't embrace their doubts or kind of pushes their doubts away or doesn't mm-hmm. say, let's figure this out together. They're coming off the, so there's something refreshing, I think, in some ways mm-hmm. about them wanting to really explore even younger who this Jesus is and really build a relationship with, mm-hmm. with Jesus, not just know about him, but to learn about him, build a relationship with him. And, you know, I think that's hopeful, especially coming off of a, you know, like I said, they're a generation above the millennials mm-hmm. who are at large part deconstructing a lot of their faith.
Gen Z is my favorite group to have in my therapy room because they are little fire starters. They are processing and questioning. And to me, I always say a loud child, an outspoken child, they feel safe. Like that's a person that feels like they can express their feelings. And so to me, that's a reflection on parenting. Like we've questioned and we're their parents are breaking cycles that let this generation say, hey, like, what's this about? Or like, let's process this more. And I think like creating space for these people, these little people, and like, I guess they're not all little people, but that's how I see it. But
some might be 27 years
old. I love them so much. But my thing is like, think about like a barbecue, how like we would get hot dogs and the hot dogs are for the kids, but we got steak for the adults.
Yeah.
And I think we like create such a separation, even in conversation. Like that's really how it's like, where it's like, okay, the kids are over here and the adults are over here. Give these kids a steak. Like they would enjoy that too. And they would enjoy having that space. And I think that they want to be listened and heard and respected by older generations. And that's inviting them in to have a piece of this part of the meal and have a piece of this part of the conversation and not separating. And so I think that that's how we foster and empower this group of
people. Well, and it reminds me of a trend I saw going around of like that people were talking about the ages of our founding fathers. And I mean, that would be Gen Z right now. And I think that's just one of those mm-hmm. things that people are shocked by, because they imagine these old dudes because they wore wigs or whatever. But it's like, no, you know, James Monroe was 18, Aaron Burr was 20, Alexander Hamilton was 21, James Madison was 25, Thomas Jefferson was 33. Okay, he wouldn't be Gen Z, you know, and it goes up from there. But I'm just still thinking, like,
we need to talk about that more often.
We wouldn't let those people have a seat at the table. Like, yeah. Anyone of that age would not be allowed to even hardly have a vote. Like, a lot of times you would just see someone go, like, pat on the head. Oh, that's cute. You have an idea. Like, but their idea could be the thing that sparks a revolution in that generation. But we in somewhere along the way in culture, we have decided that there's, like, an age where you've actually matured. And it's like,
yeah,
it's just interesting to me. I don't know. I mean, obviously lifespans were shorter then, you know, people didn't live as long. You had to kind of get done what you're getting done sooner, but still it doesn't.
And I think we've extended adolescence so far too, that, mm-hmm. you know, we've given permission. I mean, there's like generations, you know, I think of my parents and their generation, a lot more people were getting married at 19, then going to college. And then, so there's like the reaction of like, I don't want you. You are going to go through college before mm-hmm. you ever talk to someone of the opposite sex. And you're going to live in my basement
yeah.
until you have a job. And so then there's like, we as adults try to protect them from the pains and the bruises and the yeah. things that we went through that were some of the biggest character shaping things that we had. And yeah. we want to put them in bubble wrap. So at large, we also contribute to, and generationally have contributed to some of those problems. And so we have to figure out how do we reverse some of that.
Yeah, that's good.
In some ways as well, I think. So
boot
got
time.
The next one?
Boot time. The boot if we're time. Going in order. Alrighty, let's see here. These are folded so nicely. It takes me a second to unfold them. 54% of pastors under 45 considered quitting ministry. And this was in 2023, as we mentioned before. So last year, 54% of pastors under the age of 45 considered quitting. Are we surprised by this? Or do we see this in our own maybe ministries or career paths similar?
I don't know if I'm surprised.
Yeah.
I think I like, as you're reading that, I'm thinking about the things that we have looked to pastors to lead us through mm-hmm. even in the past 5 years. I'm like, I'm looking to you to give me hope for things going on in the world, things going on internationally in my own neighborhood. And then I even think there's more pressure. A lot of people are looking to pastors to say, hey, like there's this new awareness of my mental health and I'm starting to figure this out and I don't know what to do. And we're looking to pastors to say, okay, you have all the answers. Point me in the right direction, or like, tell me what's wrong or how to fix it. Mm-hmm. And I just think about, like, even with all I said, like, I just feel I have so much empathy for the pressure that's there.
Yeah.
I think the misleading thing about this statistic is I'm not surprised that, you know, 45% of pastors under 45,
54%.
54. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Sorry. I read that wrong. You can't put 54 and 45 together. Yeah. Then it's going to catch me. Anyway, 54% of pastors under 45 considered quitting ministry. And the caveat I would say is I don't think they considered quitting ministry. I think they considered quitting how we currently do this model of church.
Yeah.
And so I think that's where a lot of people have gotten fed up, as I've talked to people that are part of a residency program, to a lot of up and coming leaders, and they're looking at the needs of society. They're looking at how church functions as an organization, how church functions at even with timing wise and buildings and all that, all the processes. Mm-hmm. I think they're looking at like the book of Acts and they're like, yeah, what we're doing is biblical, but it's not also only biblical. It's also extra biblical. You know, we added, you know, some of the things like Sunday schools, and there was like a whole generation where God used Sunday school in a huge way to just educate people that had no education, couldn't read, couldn't write, and Sunday school was an opportunity for them to use Christian curriculum to better themselves mm-hmm. and kind of like our ESL does right now, is trying to teach a language for people that don't have that language and then introduce them to Jesus through that. And so I think they're looking at how the church presently functions and pushing back on, is this the way that it has to function? And do I need to be vocational in this? Like, there's a lot more people, I think, that are thinking about being bivocational. So I guess what I'm saying is I don't see a lot of people saying they're giving up this call towards ministry, because I think call towards ministry is one we all bear. As followers of Jesus, we're all, you know, told that we're supposed to be ministers to people. But I think there's really a lot of thought around, what does that look like? What have we trained, you know, Bible colleges are shutting down and all, what have we trained people to do? Have we just trained them to be people in the pulpit that preach?
And
that got really good at that? Or have we trained them to have conversations with people, to be building bridges, to have more empathy, to understand how mental health plays into this and understand people more holistically? And so I think that's what people are rejecting, that are younger, coming out of, again, that millennial deconstruction. Even those that haven't deconstructed, quote unquote, their faith or left the church are leaving how it's done.
Well, and I think it's what it's probably wise of them to see those red flags, because even though we're seeing a high percentage of Gen Z that are interested in Jesus, that doesn't necessarily mean that they're interested in the attractional model of the modern day church. And is that model sustainable? I think that's even probably a challenging question for our elders to wrestle over, you know, is like, what does church look like in 10 years, 20 years, 30 years? And when you can, like we talked about during the pandemic, when you can get preaching from anybody, anywhere, anytime, pipe directly into your AirPods, and you can get that sort of development at any moment in the day, what you really, the part that's missing is the community. It's the 12 disciples essentially going around and like being a part of a brotherhood or a community or something where you have accountability and you're challenging one another. And it is interesting to see that I think that's a really good insight, Alex, what that statistic might actually be meaning further than just at face value.
Yeah. I think for the sake of time, I'm going to grab the last one out of here.
Okay. This is our last one. You heard it officially.
Here it is. There's more in there if you want to wrestle through them with us. Here it is. 44% of non-Christians think positively about Jesus, but not the church. Are we surprised by this? How do you see this in your life? And again, I think at large, we're talking Big C Church. These questions, as they were fielded from people, are talking about the church at large. This wasn't sent to all the Christ Community Church congregants to talk about our church. So just keep that in mind as a caveat that all this stuff is talking about this. Are we surprised by that? 44% of non-Christians, they think positively about Jesus, but not the church.
Man, this just feels like it ties directly into some of these other answers.
That's what I was thinking too.
What was the one about hypocrisy? Yeah, that's
what I was thinking.
I feel like that's a big part of that. Like, hey, I'm down with Jesus and his teachings, but I don't know. These people that say they're Christ followers, Christians, don't seem to quite be following what he taught.
Yeah, Dan Campbell wrote a book, man, probably almost two decades ago, called They Love Jesus But Not the Church. And I just remember, you know, reading that and that kind of always sticking out to me. That book, he's like, I would go to my hairstylist and, you know, getting these amazing conversations about who Jesus is. And then once, you know, we said that I tied myself to a church, you know, like we could have these thriving conversations about Jesus, but the once I said I was a pastor, like, it shut it down because there was this lack of trust in the church. And I think, you know, at large, it is because of the hypocrisy, like you guys said, when people, you know, are bearing the name of Jesus, are claiming the name of Jesus, as Dr. Carl Pegenkamp has talked to us a lot about, like one of the, you know, 10 commandments is that, you know, you shouldn't use the name of the Lord your God in vain. And a lot of times we think that's saying OMG, but the reality is like, We're not supposed to just bear the name of Jesus and then walk around and live however we want. Mm-hmm. You know, that there's that's a real warning. And yet, I think oftentimes, far too often, the church can be a community club, an organization, a place where we can feel like we did some moral, you know, gymnasium training and feel good about ourselves. And it's a dangerous place to get.
Well, I think in the modern day, the church, again, big C, church in general, has become kind of an echo chamber for like-minded individuals to find refuge from a challenging culture, which, yeah, the culture is more challenging than it's ever been, but the idea of creating it, creating an echo chamber within the walls of the church, I think is the dangerous side of it. And that's probably why people who are coming from different places in the world, different lifestyles, it's going to be tough for them to feel welcome in a place where all of these people don't seem, because I think the thing, people want to be seen, they want to be known. And if you don't take the time to get to know them before you introduce them to Jesus and you just judge them first, it's going to be really challenging to get them to want to be a part of that community that just feels like a bunch of people who agree that you're an outsider and you're wrong.
Mm-hmm. I totally agree. And this, for some reason, this is bringing me back to episodes ago when we were talking about Kristen and just her working in an abortion clinic. Mm-hmm. And how even that made me think about like how Jesus is in places that we feel out of control and out of touch with. And just this, it's bringing me back to like non-Christians thinking positively about Jesus. And we get so judgy or we feel so out of control. And it's like, wow, like people are still feeling connected to Jesus, like despite the mistakes that mm-hmm. Big C Church has made, and they still have hope. And even you said earlier, Alex, about like it sounds cheesy to say like that God-sized hole, but there's something that people are searching for. And it's just neat to even in that statistic feels hopeful of like he is at work and he is drawing people to himself or.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I think a challenge I would make to people that sometimes fall into that category of just like rejecting the church at large because of their experience. And they had maybe a negative experience or because of what culture says or because of what the signs Westboro Baptist had is I think all of us want to be treated as unique and understand that our experience is unique. And so sometimes I think people will reject, they don't want like their thoughts or the things that they're involved in to just be rejected based off of, you know, the bad apples or the people that are, you know, give negative publicity. And so I think sometimes what can happen is people will just reject it based off past experience or based off of an experience they heard from somebody else and then never really give it a shot. And so then in the inverse, they're really calling the church very judgmental while mm-hmm. being very judgmental and hands off-y themselves. And I think that's the dangerous balance that sometimes people can get into is because the reality is like Jesus and the church are inseparable. Like that Jesus, the church is Jesus's bride and he's going to come back for his bride. And this is the hope that Jesus has. And so to love Jesus is to love his church, and it's going to be flawed. It's going to be messy. But this is what Jesus said. And it's crazy. I mean, it's crazy that Jesus made this promise 2000 years ago, I'm going to build this thing and the gates of hell aren't going to stop it. And the gates of hell have tried to stop it. A lot of people in our flawed sin and our narcissism and all that kind of stuff have tried to stop it. And yet here it is continuing to prevail across the globe. Mm-hmm. Because there is something powerful and mysterious about the beauty, even in the midst of the brokenness, that is the church, mm-hmm. the people that are genuinely seeking after following Jesus and trying to become more like him, which is different than I think that just little club refuge for like-minded individuals.
And yeah, I think that's for where sure.
It's dangerous. For is sure. What you were highlighting, Eric.
Well, and I think it Okay. So we talked about Gen Z, they were probably parented by people who maybe their parents were the ones that had more of an authentic faith, maybe their grandparents. And then potentially that next generation kind of was just falling in the motions. And then Gen Z was kind of raised by parents who were just going through the motions. And so by the time it was, you know, kind of distilled down to what they had, they didn't I'm just using it as broad strokes, but potentially they didn't have a genuine faith.
Yeah.
And so then at that generation's parents were, you know, so-and-so in the children's ministry didn't let me lead the ministry. And I left the church. And so I had church hurt. And that was the reason, you know, not to discredit authentic church hurt, but a lot of times church hurt kind of boils down to something like, well, I didn't get my way.
Mm-hmm.
Or I was not living the way I should, and they called me out on it, and I didn't like that, and that's church hurt. And so then, and now you've got parents raising these kids without a side of the church and Gen Z, so they don't have an experience, and all they know is, oh yeah, my parents didn't like that. They had a bad experience, so it's not good. And so then their perspective of church is just this very loosely knitted together cluster of ideas of, oh, church is bad, the church hurt me, they're not trustworthy, and without having any indication or real world experience of what it's like to be within a strong, healthy faith community. And so I think that makes sense, because you have Gen Alpha coming up now that probably some of them don't even know who Bible characters are, you know. It's just like, which seems kind of unimaginable to us, but I think as these generations have gotten removed from the church for whatever number of reasons, whether that's valid distrust or something that maybe was just more of a mild inconvenience that led to something bigger. I think it makes sense. I think that's what we're seeing a lot. I don't think, and when I talk about the church as an echo chamber, I don't mean for that to sound negative in general, but I do think that sometimes that's what people see, is like, oh, they just hate these certain people groups and whatever.
Well, just so, Christian culture. Yeah. Like, we create echo chambers in Christian culture of our own radio, our own talk shows, our own buildings, our own everything. And it's easy to get sucked in.
Mm-hmm.
You know, those are mostly have the heart of discipleship and then building a good foundation for people to go out and be the church. But if we are spending all our time, you know, in church and not being the church, then that's where it becomes
right. Which I think that's like a kind of a double-sided coin too. Like, if the church, it should be a refuge for Christians and believers to come and, you know, and be strengthened and all of that. But I think where sometimes the American church model gets it wrong is that's kind of where it stops.
Mm-hmm.
Like, the leaders of the church are the ones that are empowered to bring new believers into the flock. Not me in the marketplace, not me in my day to day, not me. And I think even in my personal life, that's where I'm feeling kind of more challenged than ever. It's just like, what does a church look like where all of the people in that building on Sunday are also, you know that I like, what does it take to get them to know that they're empowered with the power that Christ has given us to go out into the world, the same Holy Spirit, go out into the world and bring new disciples to him. And I think sometimes, I mean, it's convicting to me, because I'm like, well, what am I doing? I can't convict the whole church when it's like, I'm probably not boots on the ground doing that either. But it's just like, how do we show that to the community? How do we do things that make Jesus appealing to the lost, and not be just the church that has a bad reputation, but these people who are Christ followers who are, you know, so attractive to a lost and, you know, failing culture that it's, I don't know. It's exciting to me to think of the possibility that's there, but it's also something that I think I'm kind of grieving that we haven't quite cracked the code yet.
I feel like some of the answers, I mean, I don't think that there's like a prescription or like a, we want to, I mean, obviously we'd want to fix it, but it's maybe not fixable. But I think some of the answers are in some of the conversation we've had today. Like, who are you judging? What kind of conversations are you having? Who are you inviting into conversations? Who are you writing off?
Yeah,
are
we
creating a safe space? Are we showing our vulnerability and not just putting up a front. And I think like when we start, if we can even incorporate just some of the things that we talked about, like, and I'm speaking out of conviction of towards myself too, I think that that's where we start to like cultivate where we're at.
Well, Alex, I'd even be curious, like when you, I mean, title of minister or pastor, it's like, there's kind of that, maybe it's an antidote, but it seems like a lot of times when someone who is very unchurched hears that, their first reaction is a lot of times they either kind of almost want to confess their sin to you or be like, oh, well, I shouldn't be around in your presence, or, you know, but a lot of that I think is rooted in shame. And and it's like, man, what if the church just was so good? Like all of the people, not the pastors necessarily or the ministry leaders, but just the people were just so good at embracing people where they were and meeting them and not letting them carry that shame, but like really just, you know, loving them like Christ would.
Yeah, I think that's true. It happens. I shared like on another podcast recently that I think one of the, I don't even know where I stole it, but it's just starting with the ABCs, which sounds super cheesy, but it's one, just like getting to a space where we agree and have common ground. This podcast was on LGBTQ plus stuff and how do we have conversations. And so if we're beginning at a conversation and starting with everything we disagree on, like we're never going to get anywhere. Like we have to have confessional community together where we agree on a certain thing. And if we can't get somebody to agree together that like God made us and God loved us, like if I cannot get somebody, that's first and foremost, like my mission is to get people to know that there is a God about them, a God that is crazy about them, that loves them, that would do anything for them, that did anything for them, that they are valued and cherished and beloved. Like if I don't believe that and they don't believe that and we don't start there, then the rest of our argument or whatever we're going to talk about is going to be messy. So whether that person believes in Jesus or not, then we can talk about where our beliefs differ. Mm-hmm. And then we can talk about, okay, and what does Christ's kingdom say about these things? But I think that's like one of those things that I've just tried to embrace and learn is just creating more confessional community for people to understand. Mm-hmm. Hey, we're on the same, we're more similar than we are different.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And our similarity begins first and foremost by the fact that we are made in the image of God and that he absolutely is just as in love with you, whatever you do, as he is in love with me, whatever I do. And I don't have any specific favors that God owes me or he's not more favorable about me. He looks at both of us as the same. And the good news is he doesn't look at us the same because of who, he sees us, but he sees his son in that because of what he's done for us. And so I think that's just one of the things I've tried to learn is, man, in a lot of these conversations, what if, like how revolutionary would it be if that person really believed that there was a God that is absolutely crazy in love with them and pursuing them and pursuing them and pursuing them.
Yeah.
Like there's just so much more freedom in that and less shame. And that's just where you asking that question reminded me of.
It's really good. Well, there's some interesting stats. There's probably a lot more we could digest, but that's enough for today. Thanks everybody for listening wherever you might be. We do appreciate you. And if you have any questions or concerns, you can always reach out to us on social media, on Instagram or TikTok at @CCCOMApodcast. Or you can send us an email to podcast@cccomaha.org or leave us a voicemail. You know, maybe leave us one of those challenging questions like we had earlier in this episode at 402-885-9930. But until next time, we'll talk to you then.